My name is Silvio, and today I'm going to talk about ZeroMQ. This is only meant as an introductory talk because there is a lot on this topic. This is our schedule for today. I'm going to give you first the introduction into ZeroMQ, what it actually is, some basic concepts behind it, and how it can be used. Then we're going to talk about transport layer and how messages are sent between nodes. We are going to see some of the main patterns that are used in ZeroMQ applications, and I'm going to tell you something about security, because this is a relatively new feature. It was introduced in this latest version. Okay, so what is ZeroMQ? As Luke already mentioned, it's not a message queue. You may assimilate it with other message queues because of its name, but don't fall for that. The truth is far more different. It has ability to be message queue. It has ability to be a lot of things, but it's primarily, I consider it as a library. It's a library that gives you building blocks, simple tools so that you can use to build all sorts of applications, from simple web applications with some simple messaging up to large-scale distributed systems. It's also a concurrency framework because it allows you to write multi-threaded applications without locks, without semaphores, mutexes, or whatever mechanism you used before. ZeroMQ has a brokerless design, which means that basically each node can communicate with other node without any intermediary node. But of course, that's not rule. If you need, from whatever reason, broker in your system, you can throw it in there with no problem. ZeroMQ is built around patterns. You saw on the slide before some of them that I'm going to show you later on. And you use also patterns to build applications. It has asynchronous input-output model, which basically allows you to process to process data in asynchronous task messages. Okay, let's now. I wanted to first to cover the transport layer. It will make things a little bit clearer when we come to the to demos. Okay, ZeroMQ gives you five transport protocols that you can use to transmit your messages between. Inter-process communication. This basically goes over on the same machine. It goes over the named pipes. In earlier versions, there wasn't support for this on Windows platform, but I think now it is. I'm not sure for that. Then there is standard TCP protocol. It is a little bit different than a TCP that you used to use. There is in-process communication, which is basically a process, which is basically communication within the same process between different threads. Then there is multicast, pragmatic general multicast, and extended pragmatic general multicast. This only can be these last two can only be used on a publish-subscribe pattern. Okay, this brings us to first pattern, and this is, I think, the probably the easiest way that you can use ZeroMQ. I think that the best way to give you some sort of insight in this is through code. This is the client code. Look at the first line. We create a new context. You're going to see this in every single ZeroMQ application, because for everything you do, you have to have a context. Then we create a socket. One note on context. If you're dealing with multi-thread applications, context is thread safe, so you can share the context, the same context between threads. But the sockets and messages are not thread safe, so don't try to access messages from different contexts. It will make your life hell. Okay, so we create a socket within that context, and we name the socket type. There's a lot of socket types. We're not going to cover everything, every of those types today. Then we connect to the server. This basically gets input from the script. This is basically the code of the demo that I'm going to show you if we would have time. Then we basically just sit in a loop and then send a request, then send 100 requests to server, and we'll display that. Okay, this is the server. This is the server-side code. Again, the same thing. We create new context. We create socket. This time is different socket. This time we are using a reply socket instead of request socket. We bind that server to a certain address and port, and then we'll just spin out to infinite loop and listen for the request coming.
This is a blocking call.
Yeah, it's a blocking call. Okay, this is the second pattern. Publish, subscribe, where you have one publisher and n subscribers. Okay, I'm going to skip this standard stuff there. Just note that it's now the sub socket as subscriber. This is the code for subscriber. This time we connect through IPC named pipe. This thing here is important because if you do not set any subscription there, you won't get anything from publisher. So you must have that set it there. And we're just going to send 10. We're just going to receive 10 replies. Note that we are doing two receives. We'll see later. We'll see just now why. Okay, this is the publisher. Okay, you can also set. You can also bind to multiple addresses, so you can listen on IPC on TCP. You can bind it to. You can connect from a subscriber to any of those. It will still work. Okay, so can anyone tell how many messages we are sending here? Six. Anyone else? Who said three? Who said three? That's correct. We're actually sending here three messages. Those are actually three envelopes that carry one message. Second. Yeah, this is the part that is missing. We are talking so much about messaging, so I wanted to actually focus a little bit on message itself. Messages in ZRMQ are atomic. So what that means, either you get it whole or you don't get it at all. From developer point of view, you don't need to worry about that. If you've done any network programming, you're probably used to stream of bytes, so you really need to know where it ends. In ZRMQ, everything that goes on the wire is a string, so it makes things simpler. So you can send even the whole objects there. You just need to serialize it to a string. For that, you can use either something that PHP has built-in, or Google Protocol buffers, or something like that. Messages can also be multi-part. That is the part that you saw on second before. So basically, we can send send message in a couple of cycles. We just need to set a flag send more, and when we are receiving receive more. And this is actually how the hello message looks on the wire. ZeroMQ has extremely efficient framing protocol. That's why it's so fast and so scalable. Okay, we were. Yeah. Okay, that was for. Those are the flags that I mentioned before. Send more and on the client receive more. This pattern is good, but it has a certain issue. When we spin off that publisher, he's going to start sending updates immediately. But connecting to publisher takes a small but non-zero time. And while the subscriber is connecting to a publisher, publisher may already be starting sending messages, and subscriber will miss those messages. And in some cases, we don't want that to happen. So instead of solution for that is publisher. We need to synchronize all subscribers to publisher. I don't have code here for that, but implementation isn't different from what you saw. Basically, you just from subscriber you need to send extra request which only purpose is synchronization. Okay, this is the last pattern that we are going to cover. Pipeline. The theory is basically the same. You have one place where you generate your tasks. You distribute that. You distribute that to a set of workers. When the workers are done processing, they all send those results to a sync. You may all see for the. Ventilator and sink, fan out and fan in, those are also terms for that. We are using push socket type because it's the one-way data distribution. This part here is where we are going to spin off a number of workers, and when they are all ready, we are going to send the load to them to process it. This is the worker code. We connect upstream to that fan out that you saw. We're using pull socket because we are pulling data in. And we are connecting also to a sink, and we are using push because we are pushing data from worker to a sink. I want to note another type of socket that I don't have here, and it's called poll. It's interesting because it can poll from everything, not just ZeroMQ sockets. It can poll from PHP standard in. It can poll basically in Unix from everything that has a file descriptor. And in Unix, everything is a file, so you can basically listen on a file changes or something like that. And this is the sync or fan in code. We are pulling data from the workers, and most of the stuff is just calculating how much time it's spent total processing and stuff like that. Now the security part. All of this stuff with the security came around in time when Snowden story started, because then the guys from iMatics, that's the company who is standing behind this software, they saw that basically security is dead and they needed to do something about it. Before ZeroMQ version 4, you would basically have to implement your own kind of security in means of encrypting messages before sending them out. Now you have security mechanisms built inside. The security architecture in ZRMQ is divided into, let's say, four layers. First, they introduced a new wire protocol, ZRMQ message transfer protocol, which basically which basically adds a security handshake to all ZRMQ connections. There are also set of mechanisms for that protocol in terms which type of security is going to be used. You have a null, that's basically what we had prior to version 4. There is plain, which allows authentication via username and password, and there is curve, which implements curve ZRMQ protocol. That's new security protocol that they developed. I'm going to talk about that curve a little bit in a short while. Curve ZRMQ implements perfect forward security. What that means is in which two peers they create session keys and they transmit those keys using the long-term keys. And when session expires, they discard those keys, those session keys, and basically data that was transmitted is not remains unreadable anymore. There is also a ZRMQ authentication protocol, which basically allows you to install and use arbitrary authentication servers. With that, you can choose what kind of system you're going to use to authenticate your users. You can make that be via configuration files, LDAP systems, databases, etc.
But it does support, it has an internal authentication system.
It has internally, but you can if you don't want to use that, you can switch to whatever system you use. And there is a separate security library curve. They added that to basically allow you all of this in versions before fourth version. This whole curve story, that's basically all about elliptic cryptography, which is considered. There are some rumors that it was backdoored by the agency. Guess who? But I'm not going to dive into that. This curve ZRMQ protocol is based on certain implementation of that elliptic cryptography. It is considered secure and fast. It doesn't have any known patents for that because this whole ZRMQ is open source. And it does provide 256-bit keys, which are equivalent to 3072 RSA keys. But this doesn't prevent for attacker to grab your data today, and in a month when he manages somehow to get your keys to decrypt that data. And that is the reason why they added perfect forward security, because that mechanism disables that. When the session is over, the data is unreadable.
So are they using open SSL for that, or are they made their own?
No, it's going over SSL, but SSL itself, it's not enough.
No, I mean, do they use OpenSSL libraries for that? Or?
Yeah, it's going, all communication is going all over SSL. And that would be it. Thank you. Are there any questions?
Yeah, I have a question. I read that when you're trying to communicate between a server and a client, that it doesn't matter which one you start first. You can first start the receiver and then start the one who receives the job for it.
Yeah, for example, that request reply. If you start the client first, it will happily wait there until the server gets up.
So when I try to send a message, it just blocks?
It blocks. It won't send it.
Like a timeout you can configure or something like that?
No, not that I'm aware of it. And but it doesn't work the other way. If the server crashes, the client won't recover. So yeah, but you can also bypass that. There are also reliable patterns, but that's behind of this presentation. All of the code, if you are interested, will be today probably on my GitHub account, so you can check it there. Okay, that would be it.